Venture capitalist firm Space Angels say space companies raised $1.7 billion of equity in the first quarter of 2019, nearly twice the sum raised in the last quarter of last year. Joining me now is Chad Anderson. He's the CEO of Space Angels. Great to have you with us.
Hi, Julie. Happy
As you can see, I'm super excited about this subject. Why is NASA doing this?
I think the news today is really two parts. Yeah. The first is to expand access to the space station. So they're going to do this through a number of means, greater access to private companies to operate there. They're going to open it up for marketing opportunities as well, which is a bit controversial. They're going to give access to NASA astronaut time, and they're also going to open it up for private astronauts to go for stays of up to 30 days. So that's very interesting, kind of supplying the market with space. And the second part is on the demand side. So this is really about enabling commercial stations and being an anchor tenant of them and sort of opening up and letting them know how much demand NASA would have for these types of stations. So
is the message here the fact that the private sector, and we've got all sorts of well-known companies now, Blue Origin, SpaceX, to name a couple of them, are they just more efficient at making these trips and utilizing things like the space station than NASA has ever been, and government money ultimately has ever been?
They absolutely are, and NASA's really starting to embrace that. So the commercial crew and commercial cargo programs are what enabled SpaceX to get off the ground, if you will. And the government is really starting to realize, you know, the efficiencies in schedule and in cost. And so they've now applied this to the Commercial Lunar Payload Services program, getting NASA back to the moon. They just awarded some contracts last week.
Yes.
And it's the same type of program where NASA is a customer of private companies. And this is what they're doing today, is they're announcing that they are now doing this in low Earth orbit as well. And so just to give you an example, the Space Launch System is NASA's big rocket that they're building, the
yes.
biggest rocket ever built. It is, you know, taking, it's years over schedule, and it's cost $30 billion to make.
$30 billion. Right.
And SpaceX has been able to do this for an order of magnitude less. And by doing so and being, you know, bringing the cost down.
How much less?
A lot less. Like an order of magnitude, like maybe $5 billion.
Wow.
And so, and this is, they've been able to develop Falcon, their Falcon rocket, and also their Falcon Heavy, which competes almost directly with it. And so it's incredible. And even amongst the commercial providers to NASA of these commercial cargo and commercial crew programs, there's quite a wide disparity. So the old government contractor, Boeing, does things in an older, you know, incumbent type of way. They are charging almost what the Russians are charging. So the Russians charge us now $80 million to get to the space station. Boeing charges a little over 70 per seat to NASA.
Yes.
SpaceX is able to do it for 44.
Wow. So when we talk about Blue Origin and we talk about SpaceX, and particularly for someone like Elon Musk, he talks about living on Mars. He talks about the sort of to the moon and beyond options here. Is it feasible when NASA makes an announcement like this to say, look, we're going to give low orbit to other people and we're going to focus on the moon and Mars?
Yeah.
In the end, it's going to be the likes of SpaceX, Jeff Bezos with Blue Origin, Virgin Galactic that actually end up getting us there, surely. I feel like NASA's being a little bit put out of business here, or at least being circumvented.
There's a bit of truth there.
Yes.
No, so what this enables NASA to do and why they've really embraced this, partially I think what you're saying is true, and a lot of people have felt that way at NASA for a long time,
yes.
which is why they've been so slow to adapt and so slow to jump on board. But they're realizing that by working with private companies and doing it for much less and doing it much faster, they're able to accomplish so much more. And so that's really, I think, it seems that the idea behind this announcement today and what they're doing in low Earth orbit is really to save them money and also generate revenue to support their bigger missions to Moon and Mars.
So 100 years ago, you worked for J.P. Morgan.
Mm-hmm.
You're a real estate
yeah.
investor. Then you switched to space, and now you're investing in some of these private companies.
Yeah.
We'll get you back on to talk about some of these because they're incredibly exciting. But how do you choose? How do you look at a company and go, you know what, this is going to be a real winner. This is going to make great return for my investors.
Yeah.
You know, I'm going to invest in you.
Yeah.
How do you go about that process, particularly in this area?
Yeah. So it's important to think about the context and when all this started. So before SpaceX, there wasn't even any access to space, so there was nothing really to invest in. And that was in 2009 when they first got took a customer to orbit.
Yeah.
Took a few years, but now we're maybe 5 to 7 years into this entrepreneurial space age. We've been investing since the beginning, so it's even since before 2009. So we've been involved, and so we've got we're without a doubt the most established, and so that really helps us get access to these companies. And we've got great networks that we've built into NASA, MIT, some of these other space incubators and startup labs. And so we really pound the pavement to get the companies to come
positive
to us.
Positive returns?
So far, again, we're on venture capital timelines here, so we're investing in startups. And the timeline is 5 to 7 years that we're looking at. And so we're right about at that time where we're going to start to see some of those returns. Our companies are doing very well on paper, and we're looking forward to some of this.
Paper returns. Yeah.